this session. We're doing a back-to-back session, mainly because lots of people had registered last time and not everybody could make it. So we're doing a second one. So the session today is plan your post-retirement money. Some of you don't seem to have retired already, so nice to see that you're planning well in advance. But for those who have already retired, it's quite simple. We have to look at retirement and seniority in a different way today. You actually have to redefine how you look at 60. Those of you who are in government jobs, it's like a cutoff point, but in life it is not. In fact, they say 80 is the new 60 and 60 is the new 40. I don't think anybody really feels retired at 60. But if you are in a government job, especially, or even in private companies which have a fixed retirement age, ending that particular job where you may have worked for 20, 30, 40 years is a definite milestone, and you have to look at the rest of your life differently after that. So you may continue to earn for a long time, but you are going to have a nest egg at that time, which you have to keep safe. Okay, there is no two ways about it, because not losing money has to be the core proposition after retirement. What I'm going to talk about in this session is how to keep your money safe. Then we have a tea break, and Devashish is talking about some simple investments that help you achieve this target about safe money and regular returns post-retirement. So as the slide shows, seniors are more fit. In fact, many of you are fitter than we are. All of us are in the rat race. So before 60, you tend to be in the rat race. After 60, you ensure that you have time for your walk, for your exercise. So it's a great time. We had Dr. Dave here, who came and led a workshop that we did along with other NGOs to send a memorandum to the government. And he says, I don't know why they call it silver years. These are the golden years of my life. And he says, I've never had a better time than now. And of course, it needs some amount of care. The good times are great. This is the negative side, because if you haven't taken care of your financial independence and your health, then India is quite an unfriendly country. So you have 100 million senior citizens, but when it comes to financial issues, there are a lot of very, very strong NGOs. There are wonderful people here who are doing a lot of work with NGOs. But on financial issues, there is very little advocacy and lobbying. Unlike in the rest of the world, where senior citizen organizations are, 40, 50 million strong, and they have a say in everything that happens in government. Here we don't have that much of a voice. Not only that, the government's attitude is that any of us who have two square meals a day, we don't really matter to them, okay? Because we are able to take care of ourselves. I can understand when 350 million people are below the poverty line, the government has to focus on them. But that is why people like us need to get connected a lot more, and we need to make our voices heard a lot more. And I hope you will, be a part of what Moneylife keeps trying to do. So inadequate regulation is something that we will keep coming up even in my session. So when I say you have to be safe with your money, it is within the parameters of what the law is today. Things need to change, and you have to be aware of it. So if you need to ever go to court, you have to remember it's not really an option. Even consumer courts, which were supposed to give you justice in 3 months, take as much as 3 years sometimes, and cases even get dismissed without being heard properly. So you need to be prepared for a few things. One is high cost of living. Costs are galloping. Your retirement nest egg is fixed. Right? And that is a core issue that affects senior citizens. I'm going to talk about how it happens. Apart from higher costs, you need to plan for a certain amount of what we call renovation. So heart bypass surgeries, knee replacements, these are things that you need to prepare for. You have to plan. It's great to say 80 is the new 60, but it also means that you're going to live for 20, 30 years on your savings. And if you're going to live on bank interest rates, it's going to be tough. So that again is part of the second session, where Devashish talks about what you can do to safely ensure that you earn a little more and beat inflation. Because otherwise, if you're depending on bank fixed deposits, then inflation is eating up your savings, even though you think that you're getting interest, and that interest is taxable. So you have to also prepare for fluctuating income. Whatever you do, even bank interest rates fluctuate these days. And if you put it in anything else like mutual funds, they also go up and down depending on the market. There are a lot among us who are going to be property rich. All of us Indians focus on the roof on our head when we start earning, right? So, in fact, I remember that the first 20 years that I was earning, I said, I don't even have to worry about personal finance, because where is the finance? Every penny that I could save went into EMIs, because I was paying back home loans. When I could pay for a small house, I began to pay for a slightly bigger one. So there was no financial planning required. And believe me, that is one of the reasons why it is most difficult for us to get younger people here to listen to what to do with your money at the time when they should. Okay, because there's, you know, we didn't even have children. Those who have children, there is no money at all. Once you have your EMIs and you're looking after children's education, for 20 years, there is no thinking. You're in a sort of treadmill, and whatever you get goes away to somebody, either college, school education, or paying back EMIs. So what do we have when you retire? You have this property, which luckily in India, property prices have been going up, and you may often end up with very little cash. So today you have products like reverse mortgage. Again, we'll come to that a little later. But you can draw down from that wealth that you have created by paying EMIs over 20 years. It is not a great product. Okay, if more of you are with us, we should be really fighting hard to make this an effective product like there is around the world, because around the world, this product is backed by the government to a certain extent. Here, the risk is taken by banks and insurance companies, so they give you lower returns. But it at least exists. We are lucky that this product has been introduced about 5 to 7 years ago, and we have an option to extract value from the property that we have built. So, like I said again, avoid losses is the first principle. Avoid financial and emotional traps, and I'm going to explain what they are. Safe and sensible investments so that you at least keep beating inflation, so that your nest egg remains constant. Strive for financial independence. I think everybody understands that it doesn't matter what your children do and how much you've invested in them. I think at the time when you're looking at it, we did a survey here, okay, and we discovered the survey was answered by a lot of people, many of them online, so they're all earning well. But what we found is that Indian parents spend so much on their children's education, far more than they can afford. And many people were admitting to us in the survey that the cost of their children's education was so high, they were not at all sure whether they're going to have any savings left for retirement. Okay? And I think this is going to be really tragic, because education costs have really galloped in the last 10 to 15 years. It's become more and more expensive. Medical costs have galloped in the last 10 to 15 years. You combine these two, and if people between the age of 30 and 50 are not planning well, they're going to be in serious trouble, because this is a country which has no social security, and they may end up earning forever. Hopefully, everybody in this room is not in that position and at least has one big property asset that can take care of them at a pinch. So like I said, avoid losses. To avoid losses, you know, after 2008, when we had this big global financial crisis, the new thinking that has happened, you know, when we had this financial crisis, countries went bankrupt. You remember some countries like Iceland, forget about banks collapsing, even whole countries collapsed. And when people looked at it afterwards, they said, how is it that sane, sober, normally smart people invested in some of those what is called toxic mortgages, when in retrospect, on the face of it, it looked so ridiculous. But people tend to make those kind of investments. So there was a lot of neurological studies that happened to say, why is it that people are doing this? And these are some of the new findings. So we're talking about things that have been discovered and now emphasized post-2008. One is that in spite of so many thousand years of evolution, ordinary people are not hardwired to understand financial products. There are some people who are very good at finance. It is not about knowing your tables and learning them from the time you're 2 years old. All of us have done it. But there is a certain kind of mind that understands mathematical issues and mathematical and economic economic issues together. Ordinary people are not geared to do it. And frankly, this is good news, because for years together, we've been beating ourselves up saying, is it my fault that I made a mistake? You know, I got cheated, because the ruling dictum was caveat emptor, which is buyer beware. Right? So however complex the product, there would be fine print, terms and conditions. You were supposed to understand it. If you didn't, they would ask you, did you sign on it? Did you not read? For God's sake, we can't understand anything that's there. It's legalese and it's complex. But you were expected to know it. Not that any of us did. We would ask, kaha sign karna hai? We would sign it. Which is why when things went wrong, there was no recourse, because it was caveat emptor. Today, thanks to new research, people are beginning to understand that a majority of people do not understand financial products. Okay. Second, they translate their experience of buying consumer goods to financial products. So what happens? There are two or three things you do. One is, of course, a big brand is equal to better returns. So you think that, you know, oh, my neighborhood cooperative bank is not good. Let me go to Citibank. It'll give me a better service or better returns or better advice. No, in the financial world, it doesn't work like that. Only in the financial world. If you go and buy, you have a Nano or you have a Lamborghini, is there a difference? Huge, right? And that difference is in the money you pay. Strangely, in the financial world, whether you go to Citibank or you go to the small neighborhood bank which doesn't even have a functioning AC, the returns you will get may be similar. What you may have in terms of difference is a nice ambience. Citibank may have a nice marble lobby and give you a cappuccino when you go. Other than that, when it comes to your money, in fact, you're paying for everything, you're paying more in Citibank than you will in a small place. So do not translate your experience of buying consumer goods to the financial world. The second thing is, I've already talked about brand. You know, you're buying a product, you take it, you go away. You buy a toaster, you plug it in, it works. You buy a washing machine, it works. Even a car as fancy as this, you have the money, you can pay cash down, you can actually drive it away. Any financial product is going to be at least a year before you know whether you've made a sensible decision or not. Except maybe stocks, you will see the price going up and down. But if you worry about a stock price going up and down on a daily basis, then that again is a bigger mistake. But everything else, for instance, can you test drive a mutual fund? You will know whether you invested in the right fund. You know the past. So you have a little line at the bottom of all mutual fund ads which say past is no guarantee of the future. Right? So you will know 1 year down the line what is the return that your mutual fund has paid, and you need to stick with it for the long term, which is why you cannot afford mistakes. It's usually too late. In insurance, it's even worse, because only when you make a claim will you know whether you've done everything right or not. The third thing that happens when it comes to financial products, actually in all products, but more so in financial products, because everywhere else you have a sales pitch, but you're seeing the product, you plug it in, it works. The financial world, you're only going by sound bites, right? So business is hard selling something to you. Maggie Noodles is telling you there's no MSG, so you're buying it for years together. Madhuri Dixit is telling you it's the healthiest snack, you're eating it, not much damage. But when you buy a home trade or you buy some, you know, child plan because Sachin Tendulkar has asked you, it's a huge difference that it makes to your wealth. Second is, everybody who is an agent or a distributor is doing it not because he loves you, but because of the commissions that he gets. So your first interest is commercial. Not that it's necessarily wrong, not that it means bad advice, but lots of people also get cheated because of that. The third is the media. We depend on ads. Media is primarily interested in the advertising that they get. Okay, and increasingly these days with paid news and what is called native advertising, which is editorial pretending to be news, you have to be able to look through it rather than say Times of India mein likha hai, toh barabar hi hoga, which is what used to happen when we were younger. People used to make us read the Times so that we improve our knowledge and our language skills and whatever. These days you have to be able to see through, read in between the lines to understand what exactly they are saying. And what happens then is we expect all these people to deliver on their promises, which doesn't necessarily happen. When you are 60 plus, there is one more issue that begins to kick in, which is what is called cognitive impairment. There is enormous amounts of research about this also. We would all like to believe we can do mental exercises to make sure it doesn't affect us much, but it is a reality that most of us should recognize, and I'm going to give you a few examples of why and how you need to look at it. 80% of scam victims in the US are over 65. In any case, whether it is a financial scam or it is crime and murder, all statistics of any police department anywhere in the world will tell you more than 50% of it is your close friends and neighbors. So when it comes to finance also, don't worry, your own close people are more likely to cheat you than a completely independent advisor who needs you for business. This is something you need to keep in mind. I'm not saying start being suspicious about everybody, but don't be trusting or overly trusting. Elder abuse, as they call it, they at least have statistics. 2.6 billion every year is what people, senior citizens, are losing. Every single email scam is first targeted at senior citizens because they say they trust more. And that's why I'm saying get a second opinion. And I'm going to explain with a couple of examples why. This has got nothing to do with whether you're smart or you're dumb or you've, in a doctor or an engineer or have you studied mathematics. In fact, studies again show smart people are easier to cheat. In fact, I have a joke over here. I keep saying doctors are the people who got the 90 percentile and went and did medicine, right? I have so many stories about doctors being cheated. They're smart. Every other day, it's IAS officers that you will find. In fact, I've taken out some examples, but believe me, it's got nothing to do with how smart or how clever you are. It has to do with how diligent you are and how careful you are about reading what is being sold to you. So smart people are easier to cheat, probably because they think they're so smart that nobody is going to take them for a ride. And I'll give you a couple of examples, okay? Now look at this. This is a case of Mr. Rakshit. He's a marine engineer. He had 72 lakhs in HSBC. This is a case, I'm keeping this session only with two cases because there is just no explanation. So only explanation is the cognitive impairment thing that I've talked about. His wealth manager runs up a loss of 25 lakhs in his mutual funds in HSBC. He doesn't withdraw it. He grumbles. The guy says, I'll put it back, and he believes him. He then gives a check of 44 lakhs to a company which belongs to the wealth management guy's father. He then writes a 11.5 lakh check in the relationship manager's mother's name. Then he transfers a flat in Calcutta to their name. He actually goes to the registrar's office and signs on it. Then his daughter gets to know about all of this, and she starts writing to us, starts writing to the RBI and says, do something. And honestly, I am nonplussed. I don't even know what one can say. Obviously, it was dismissed from everywhere. The banking ombudsman also dismissed this complaint because they said, how on earth can this person do it? And when I ask her, where were you when your father was making these investments? Did he even talk to you? Did you ask, why are you coming to us now? She has no answers. She says, my father trusted the man. And this story I've heard repeated a million times over, okay? Some chartered accountant, somebody who is unrelated, the children will come back and say, but my father trusted him. Why? We don't know. My only explanation for this is the cognitive impairment theory. Some people in the last seminar said maybe he was hypnotized. I don't know. But this is a real story. He has no explanation for why he did this. And he's a clever man. So I keep saying, keep somebody informed. At least people in your own families. If nothing else, out of their self-interest, wanting to inherit it from you sometime, are going to make sure that you're being a little careful with your money. So don't keep people completely in the dark and don't depend 100% on strangers. This is another case which was referred to us by a senior IAS officer. This is a senior manager in Tata Motors. He invests the provident fund of people over there, which runs into hundreds of crores of rupees. Okay, so he's a guy who understands finance, he understands numbers, and yet in his personal wealth, he buys for his family as well. He has bought 39 policies, which he has to keep paying a huge amount of money. He's invested 33 lakhs and he suddenly discovers he has to keep making those investments for another 10 years or he gets nothing. And they come to us and say, can you do something? Now, straight look at this, my answer would be no, because how do I give him benefit of doubt? I believe him, okay? Let me say very clearly, I believe him, but is this something that I can fight? I can't, because how does a person buy 39? And believe me, 39 is the highest we have come across. But we have come across cases of retired professors in Assam buying 18 policies. We got them the money back on 7 or 8 after fighting for it. Here also we will try. But I mean, I don't know how it's going to work. And especially given his background, it's going to work against him, because people are going to say, we do not believe you didn't know. At least a retired professor from Assam who doesn't know English very well got benefit of doubt. Even there, you know, we got money back. He bought three insurance companies. Two of them returned the money. One has stubbornly said, fight it out, we are not going to return the money. So it doesn't always work. But this is what I call possibly the effects of cognitive impairment, and it is something that everybody has to guard against. Any questions here? I'm going to go segment by segment and we'll look at things. Okay, good. So we go to the next one, avoid unregulated schemes. So we say first precaution, ensure that it is regulated. And when, you know, it's not that because SEBI is regulating it or the insurance regulator is regulating it, there won't be a problem. But at least a regulated scheme gives you a fighting chance of getting redress. If you don't, you don't even know who to go. You'll file a police complaint, but nothing much happens. So part one, ensure that it's a regulated scheme. So it's either the pension regulator, RBI, whatever. And there are innumerable examples of people having gone and invested thinking it's as good as a regulated scheme. All of you remember what happened in the 90s with the plantation scheme, strawberry, grapes, what have you. After that, you have even as recently the EMU scam, right? Then you have art funds. Art funds had everybody from the governor's son to whatever had invested in OCEAN. Nothing has happened to OCEAN. Few people, I think about 20-30 people who wrote through Moneylife got at least the principal back. Everybody else hasn't got a penny. He is fighting the case in SEBI, knowing fully well that if he goes through every legal remedy available to him, he is buying at least 15 years of time. And time is not something you have in plenty when you're living on your savings, because you need the money. Finally, guaranteed return of realty schemes has been going on in a big way in the last few years. And sometimes people have come here and said, but you know, the company is a listed company. It is listed company looked at by SEBI, but the realty schemes that they're giving you are usually unsecured, usually in cash and not regulated by SEBI. There's no realty regulator. Okay, there's no regulator for real estate. So please be wary. They've been offering anywhere between 15 to 20% interest. And the whole sector is in the doldrums, as you know now. So if you have money there, please find a way to even now take it out. Then we come to Ponzi's, MLMs. All these are chain marketing schemes. Anything that says that we'll give you a return which is even 3% higher than a bank FD is something you need to worry about. All these schemes offer you extremely high returns, and one condition that they usually have is you have to bring two or more people. So they'll have this left hand, right hand, but the condition is come and join us, you get a high return, and you need to introduce two more people. That's what forms a chain or a pyramid. Okay, and this is fooling people even today. I keep saying, if we didn't run a magazine and didn't waste our time trying to do financial literacy seminars, instead if I put a board out there saying guaranteed 20% return, I would have a queue outside. Just 20%. I'm not talking even about 200 and 300%. Okay, because people are pouring money. Every single Ponzi scheme that I've looked at, minimum 1,000 crores in 1 year. This is the kind of money they collect. We are so ready to write checks to these people. And what is the point that everyone says? You know, my neighbor, wo to CA hai, usne dala, to, you know, it must be safe. Or somebody else is a policeman. These are the guys, you know, they actually track people like that because they build credibility. And I've kept saying, when the economic offences wing goes after these people, all the RBI income tax people who have invested in these schemes get their money out first. You and me are left without anything. It is part of the scheme to show that someone gets it. So if he says, I will pay you monthly returns or quarterly returns, the first person who gets a check at a 200% return or a 20% return is going to go around saying, are, it's a good company, I got a check or I got a dividend. And that is seen as, you know, underlining the fact that they're safe. In fact, that is the part of the game. And what happens, I keep saying, is very simple. If you have put in 10,000 rupees and you have got a couple of checks, you have introduced 8 new people by now, so you are a nice little group which is feeling very happy that you're getting these very, very high returns. You've started spending. So what do? Will you stop at 10,000? Impossible, right? Because you're so sure it's working. So you are now breaking all your bank FDs and putting more and more money. So when the pyramid grows large enough and they run away, actually all your money is gone there. So the damage is significantly higher, because if you fall for it and get roped in, you are going to withdraw more of your safe savings and put your money there. And I'm not talking through my hat. This is day before yesterday's paper. All of you have read this story, right? This woman who acted in Madras Cafe. I mean, look at the returns. When you look at 200 to 400% returns, what on earth can you invest in? It's such a big struggle to beat inflation. Isn't it? And this woman was offering 400% returns, and look at the amount of money. She is also talking about, I think, a few hundred crores that they've already collected. Today morning I was reading the paper. We talk about a Nigerian scheme. Here's an actor, 7 lakh rupees, yeah. Right? Today's Times of India. So when I talk about Ponzi, I keep saying that in India, the one thing that is wiping out people's savings, from the richest to the poorest, Sharda scam, 23 suicides, okay? So these are absolutely poor people, or you're talking about Sahara. The biggest ever losses are in unregulated Ponzi schemes. You now have SEBI looking at what is called collective investment schemes, but usually by the time SEBI even gets to know that the scheme is there, because it's all word of mouth, each person is getting 2 more people, it's running quietly. When some people are getting returns, before you know it, it's, you know, 400, 500 people already involved. That's the time when a regulator gets to know. Usually the regulator does not act until the money collected is running into a few hundred crores. And I have not yet known in India of anybody having got their money back. Okay?
The glaring example is Michael Ferreira.
Michael Ferreira of QNET, in fact.
He's a good talker.
Absolutely.
Came
to y'all also?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I told everybody from our group, just don't believe in that, whatever.
So QNET is a big one, and QNET is another one which has very young people, college students, it's called QNET, and it's coming back in various forms. It came as Gold Quest, then it was QuestNet, so they changed their names, and these are international schemes. Then there are email traps, okay? So which is, you know, the African dictator, the Nigerian scam. So this actor who gave 7 lakhs was in the Nigerian scam. Somebody else I know who headed a consumer organization lost 35 lakhs, Ahmedabad, in this scam. So if anybody who says, I'm the son of an African dictator, I have 25 million of, you know, ill-gotten money stashed away, can I route it through your account and send it to your country? We'll share it 50-50, or I'll give you 30%. Please do not believe. This is what is called the advance fee scam. Because what do they do? I mean, all of us feel we are not gullible. We are not going to fall for the 25 million. But you reply because you're tempted. Most people will say, "Dekhte to kya hai?" Let's see what they say. Each reply is extremely well documented and very, very well written. They will convince you the money is coming, but they'll say there's some small hitch, okay? So the day before it's supposed to come, you know, I need some small amount paid. Will you pay? It can be as low as 1,000 rupees. It can be 1,500 rupees. So with 25 million that you're supposed to get, you pay that. Which means that they've now established your gullibility, right? So they get, their documentation gets better and better. They have their whole story very well worked out. And this is a global scam. These are very, very smart guys. They're not cooking it up as they go along. They have it fully done. They even say they have diplomatic sources. I know people who have gone to Goa because they said, we will get the cash in diplomatic bags. And they have gone to Goa and found nothing comes. So there are lots of examples. Some people have gone to Nigeria to chase the person and got locked up in Nigerian jails because they're hand in glove with the Nigerian police. There's as much corruption in Nigeria as there is in India. Okay, so don't go down that road at all. You get an email, please ignore it. Similarly, even if you get an email from the income tax or the Reserve Bank governor saying there's money in an escrow account which your great grandfather left and you didn't know or you've inherited, these are the mails that come. And they are so widespread, every single RBI governor has mails sent in his name. Subba Rao had mails sent in his name, Raghuram Rajan has mails sent in his name. And if you get a mail from the RBI governor for whatever reason, you will see in his signature there is a line which says Raghuram Rajan, Governor, Reserve Bank of India. At the bottom is, we do not have any escrow accounts, we are not keeping any money, don't fall for mails that come in the name of the governor. This scam is that widespread that he has had to put it in the signature to his emails. Okay, so don't fall for that either. All mails that tell you, close friend, I went to Spain, I couldn't tell you, I went to Paris, I was robbed over there, please send some money to me by Western Union, please pick up the phone and talk to him, he'll be very much in India and tell you that he's received 20 other calls like this. Okay, because this is another sort of virus which affects your address book. So everybody in your email address book gets that mail to say that somebody is stranded. So it's usually a person you know and someone you know very well and whose email ID is in your address book. Okay, so this is one which obviously people fall for quite regularly and you keep getting it. Next is the phishing and wishing, which is identity theft. This is also, I'm sure, very widespread. You, every single time you'll get a mail saying verify your account or it's going to be shut down. So you get a little startled. All the documentation is very, very authentic looking. The logos of the banks and everything is so perfectly done. But just understand standard. No bank is going to ask you to verify an account and put your PIN number and details because that robs your identity. Then they use the basic data that they get to change address and change your password and get hold of your accounts. They make, phishing is when it comes on email. Wishing is when they make you a call. I got a call yesterday. Okay, they take big banks at random because by and large they call me up. They said, you know, aap Sucheta ji hai? I said, haan. Aapka ICICI bank mein account hai? Haan. To aapne aadhar card submit nahi kiya hai, to aapka account band kiya jayega. Luckily, I know this is yesterday's story. These calls are happening all the time. I took the number and I sent it to ICICI Bank saying, you may want this traced and file a complaint. They take it down, but they say we are filing hundreds of these every day. I mean, they were lucky it matched. It could have been a call which said that maybe I'm, and you know, today, in fact, the next seminar that we are doing on the 20th is something that you all may want to attend. It's all about data privacy, cybercrime, and identity theft. How easy it is and how many tracks we leave every time we go onto the internet. So the internet is a great boon to all of us. If you don't use it properly, it can just wipe out the money that you have and you can fight for it, but it takes a long time and a lot of mental anguish before you get there. So you're leaving tracks. There is something called Truecaller. You know, if they get hold of your mobile, all they need to do is put it over there and get your name. It's not difficult. And when people are making lists very carefully by tracking you through Facebook or tracking you through some shopping you've done, maybe some, you know, list has gone off from one of the shoppers, you know, where you've gone and given it, maybe for an award, maybe for something else, maybe as a necessity. I'm not, again, let's be very clear, we're coming to more of this. I'm not saying don't share the mobile with important service providers, but this is a reality that we have to live with. Any questions here or we go to the next section?
I got a call saying that if you give me your details, we'll give you a short kind of a holiday or something, and please, there's a seminar which you have to come and attend, and it's like it's a, you don't have to pay anything, but if you come, correct, probably you can, we'll give you a free holiday and...
No, those are the worst ones, those are not this, okay, that is where you get trapped in the QNets and, you know, those timeshare schemes and whatever, because those are the ones where, I don't know whether you get hypnotized, because all they want you to come with is your checkbook. And I'm told a lot of people go out and sign a check and come.
It's a free seminar and you'll be giving me a short of it.
That is what they told you. You don't know what will happen if you go there and come out, no? Having come, have you bought the scheme? If you say, I went there, I wasn't convinced, I had a nice dinner and came back, then I will say, okay, great, I've got to listen to this. But I have heard hundreds of people, including foreign bankers who have called me, and this is going on for the last 25 years. The scam is not new. That come to so-and-so hotel and we'll talk to you. Some of these were being conducted in five-star hotels. But the whole idea is to trap you into some kind of scheme. That is the bottom line.
Wine Society of India has sent an offer with some discount, and what they have said is that give your credit card number so that anytime you want, we'll just send you a mail. If you say no, in the next 4 days, we'll wait for your answer. If you don't, we don't receive an answer, we assume you want the next order, and we'll debit the money from your credit card. So I refused. I said, I don't want to give it. So they just kept me on the mail. And they regularly call 15 days or so and say, some nice new thing has come, would you like, etc., etc. So the last time when I showed some interest in taking something, they said, and we will debit it straight from your credit card. So I said, but how do you have my credit card number? So they said, no, we have it because we once did a transaction for you and our back office will be able to manage it.
Actually, no, it doesn't happen. There are two reasons. One is that, they can't auto-debit because luckily in India, you have a two-stage thing. You have to do a second verification. And one of the reasons why, you remember the whole controversy over Uber. Uber around the world has a direct debit. India does not allow it. You have to put in your PIN or your CVV. And without it, they can't do it. So, you haven't completed the transaction. So, I don't know what was going to happen in this case. But if they try and do that, it is illegal. They can't just deduct it, and it's something that you can complain to the RBI.
Back office is able to do it,
they can't. The RBI requires that you need to have a two-stage. It's been there for a long time. Definitely before, I think, this Wine Society, because even I get these mails. They're about 2-3 years old.
I'm asking him because it happened to me in JW Marriott,
where they deducted. I was giving them a present of 1 year's gourmet that this, and it was deducted directly, exactly as she says, and I was...
But you had put in your card details.
I had put in my card details, but not my IPIN, not my anything. And
my point is that Uber was also doing it, so we need to complain. You need to complain to the RBI.
Immediately.
Okay.
But that's why I'm asking, when did the...
Complain to the RBI. There may be people doing it illegally, but the RBI is very clear. That's why Uber had to change its entire policies, right? And they...
About 3 years back, exactly.
Yeah, so I think they would have been doing it.
This was just 15 days back.
If they did debiting it directly, please complain to the RBI. Yeah?
I just have a question for the earlier thing where we get this emails. Now, my junk folders, practically most of these emails are with this. I keep blocking them and deleting them. Is there any other option or any other way, or you just keep getting it all the time?
There is no option. In fact, I met somebody from Yahoo, very senior person recently. I used to diligently go and unsubscribe to some of these mails. And he says, actually, unsubscription is even worse because now they know it's a live ID and there's a real person that exists over there and it's a running account. So they say that they will put it in a separate list and sell it. So he says, it may be grit your teeth and delete, but don't unsubscribe. So this is something, we share things that we learn, and I must tell you, even I learned this 3 days ago, because I used to sit and unsubscribe everything very patiently.
That's what I do, yeah. So I was wondering, but I keep getting more and more, so I was just wondering how come I'm getting...
Probably, happens with me, so I think unsubscribing was the wrong thing to do.
What is the recourse for the unregulated scheme?
Unregulated scheme, there's no recourse. Unfortunately, you can file a police complaint with economic offences, okay, that you've been cheated. Other than that, then you wait for them to act on it. Sometimes it works. lot of times, if you're lucky enough to go with a good inspector or someone who's helpful, it may work. He will go and arrest, and nothing like the threat of arrest to make people cough up money really fast. So if it's small-time crooks, they usually don't want to go to jail, they'll return your money. But if it's this large scheme, especially when it is multinational and whatever, it's running in several countries like QNET and others, then they just get top lawyers and they will keep delaying things, nothing happens. Yeah, so that's why no unregulated schemes is what we talk about.
Excuse me.
We are having for telephone bills and
other things. I have heard one person, they are telling they have deducted twice the bill. Then again, the same thing happens to them. They have deducted twice the same thing.
Really? Possibly.
This is from a bank?
No, ECS normally works well because they have proper systems and you are signing up. So whether it is your electricity bill or... If you have a case like this, please tell them to write to our helpline because it's preposterous. Okay? So, I mean, I'm hearing this for the first time. So, yeah? Then do write to us. Do write to us. Let's take it up with, you know, we have a...
Madam, she was a doctor, Dr. Nirmala Devi, my doctor, and she suffered from that. She told me that
it has happened.
So, we have a legal...
Also, doctor colleagues.
Okay.
It has been happening that once through ECS, next month...
Which, is it a particular... organization maybe which has weak systems?
Bank is, I think they are bank, the people whom I know, I think they are banking with Kotak Bank.
Please write, if you know someone, tell them to write to us, we'll take it up. We'll take it up with the RBI also because it's very shocking if ECS systems are like this. If it is supposed to be monthly, it has to be deducted monthly and they ought to pay. Because now the RBI has a consumer charter, they not only have to ensure that they, you know, resolve this immediately, we need to ensure that they have a systems check because there is some problem with the system then that allows this to happen twice. And the third thing is that your rights have been enhanced under a consumer charter, so they can't cheat you like this. You should be able to get it resolved without harassment, but they need to fix their systems. Right? Anything else?
You have the numbers of RBI where you can complain.
I'll share the emails.
Yeah, please.
They are very unfriendly on the phone, but emails usually work. So I will share the emails with you. So when it comes to banking, so what do we do with our money? Safe banking is usually in banks, right? So large banks, large private banks, foreign banks I'm not going to talk about because what they do globally I don't know, but even there, 2008 they shut down something called Lehman Bank, and I think the world acknowledged that that was a mistake because it triggered a bigger collapse. So Citibank was on the verge of a collapse, but the government bailed it out. AIG was bailed out. So the practice around the world is too big to fail. So in a way, for small people like us, the bigger the bank, the bigger the organization, there's safety in it because the economy can't allow such a big entity to fail and they take care of it. So in India, you know that Global Trust Bank was one of the new private banks, and way back in 2000 also, they did not allow it to fail. They forced it to get merged with a public sector bank, so people's deposits and money and everything was safe. So we have no known case in the last 30 years or more of any large bank failing. Okay, so there is safety in large banks. If you get an SMS saying some bank is running out of its money and it's among the top 10 banks, please do not worry, do not rush, because the government by and large takes care of you. We are even better off because more than 40% of our banking system is nationalized banks. So even when their net worth is eroded, Sarkar is taking care of you. That we are lucky about. Okay, so NPAs today are so high. If it wasn't for the fact that they are Sarkari banks, believe me, all of us would have had to panic and start worrying about it. On the other hand, cooperative banks are a huge problem. Small private banks and cooperative banks fail at the rate of at least one a month. And those of us whose job it is to track this, one small release will come from the RBI. In the business press, which most of you will not read, there will be a one para write-up saying this bank failed or that bank failed. And please remember, these are under dual regulation of the Registrar of Cooperatives, which is fully politicized, as well as the RBI, which means that neither of them regulate them well. We have sent complaints about innumerable banks, nothing happens. And even after their net worth is fully eroded, RBI will not send that letter saying the bank is closed or liquidated for nearly a year after there is a problem and they stop paying deposits. So I keep saying, our hard-earned money, I would not put it in a cooperative bank. There is only 1 lakh per person that is guaranteed by the deposit insurance, and I would not put more than 1 lakh in a cooperative bank. I may keep it if it's right next door. So for convenience, you keep up to 1 lakh, but not more than that. And please do not argue that we should have this deposit insurance enhanced, because all you will do is allow political people and political leaders to rip off these banks, and we will be paying, because ultimately somebody pays. Okay, so everybody pays for the insurance. Nationalized banks, foreign banks, private banks, everybody pays the deposit insurance. The only claimant in the last 30 years are cooperative banks. And why does this happen? Because of the political interference that stops regulation. So I think the better way, there are just two or three large cooperative banks which are almost like nationalized banks, which I would consider safe, again for the same reason that they are large, okay, and they are fairly profitable. Other than those, sorry, very obviously, yeah, that is the largest. I think in fact it's very soon going to be a scheduled commercial bank. Shamra Vittal is another one, but the rest of them, tiny tiny ones, single branch, two branches, please don't touch them, whether it is your community or not. Saraswat Bank is a community bank, but now it's huge, but people fall for it because it'll be, you know, Syrian Christian or some Memon or something. Please don't fall for that. Does not make it safer. Don't buy any bonds or equity shares thinking that makes your money safe. In fact, you lose three times over. I know some people, my own aunt, she says, "Par mala share deta hai." I said, no, you lose the shares and you lose the deposit also. So please don't put your money there, right?
This last one you are talking of is for cooperative banks or any other?
See, what happens is a deposit insurance is available for everybody. Okay, it's available for everyone, but the only claims that have been paid out in the last 25 years are on account of failed cooperative banks. They're the only ones who have failed.
The nationalized banks are safer.
Nationalized banks, large private banks, nothing has happened. Not a single penny.
Ma'am, this one, like per depositor is per
sorry?
The last point.
Not per account, per entity.
Per entity, no matter.
Yeah, so if you say I have 10 fixed deposit accounts, you won't get 10 lakhs. It'll be your name, one identity. Okay, so some tips now that banking has changed, okay? 30, 35 years ago, we used to trust the bank manager, go and spend time with him, and anything that the banker said was safe. Not anymore, because banks sell you the maximum number of toxic products, insurance, mutual funds, even the art funds that I talked about, Ocean, was hard sold by ABN AMRO. Insurance is sold by them, 2 years later they'll say, we have no relationship with them, don't come to us with a problem. Ocean, headed by Meera Sanyal, I'm sorry I'm naming names, but Aam Aadmi Party, I keep sending a mail saying, what did you do about people who got cheated? I've left the bank, you know, we sold the retail portfolio, I don't care. That is the answer that you get, okay? So ask questions. Anything that you hear from a relationship manager, get it cross-checked, because most of the products they sell you are not because they're good for you, but because they get the highest returns. Having said all this, you know, I'm going to make another point, which is RBI has announced a consumer charter in December last year. The consumer charter still at the moment is a motherhood statement. Among the various rights is right to suitability of products, which I've mentioned at the end, which means that your bank relationship manager has to talk to you, has to know your finances, know your needs, and only sell you products that are suitable to you. As of this time, all it means is that you can fight for your rights, okay? But RBI has not specified what will be the penalty for not following the right to suitability or treat your customers fairly or cheating them. So what they're going to do is still out there. They're discussing it. I was called for a meeting on the 25th with the RBI governor along with some other consumer organizations, but nothing is decided as yet. But at least it's framed that these relationship managers can't do what they used to do in the past with impunity. I keep saying store the numbers. Usually the relationship manager changes his job every 3 months. But that's why take the number of his boss and his boss's boss so that when you have an issue, you can write to them. The third thing I say is that if they make you a false promise that your ULIP is going to give you a 20% return or a 30% return, they say anything, okay? People have come here and said all kinds of things. The Sucheta Krishnamurthy case where we helped her get 1.37 crore, they said guaranteed 30% you'll get on ULIPs, which is completely untrue. So put it down in writing. Write to them with copies to their bosses saying, you met me on so and so day, you have recommended that I invest in this product, you have said that I will get a guaranteed return of so and so, please confirm this is true before I sign the check. Okay, now some people will say they don't reply to that. Okay, they don't reply to it, but you have a written document that you asked them, that you didn't ask only the relationship manager, you asked, you copied his boss also, right? You have proof, you have, you're creating a trail, which means that if you get cheated and you go to the banking ombudsman, the fact that you asked the questions and you didn't get an answer is decided is in your favor. And in 9 out of 10 cases, or I would say 10 out of 10 cases, they quietly pay up if you can produce that proof when there's a fight. In fact, they will not come to sell you the product at all. So 50% chance of you getting cheated is eliminated right there, because once you put that in writing, they will not come back to sell the product. They may come back and say, no, forget this, I'll give you an even better one, and try and lure you to something else. But create that safety mechanism of written documentation. Sometimes even that doesn't work, as happened with Mr. Mangelal Sharma, 79-year-old. He's a former multinational person, so knew exactly what he's doing. But same thing, uncle, bahut achha scheme hai. The bank manager comes to his house and he says, we have a new fixed deposit, because he used to invest only in fixed deposits. So he says it's called Develop Your Wealth Scheme. So he says it's called DWS. And he tells him, main sab bhar dunga, just write DWS and sign. And so he signed. The next month he gets a statement and he found that they had put his money in a Deutsche Bank equity mutual fund with a 5-year lock-in. So his point was that this is money I had kept aside because my wife had to go through a knee replacement surgery. In any case, at the age of 79, I don't want any money in a fixed deposit. If I need it, I want to use it. I mean, I'm not going to lock up anything. He lost with the banking ombudsman because all they asked him, this is where I'm saying that suitability of products is come after December. So he could have argued that this product was not suitable to me and you've sold it. That time all they asked him is, did you sign or not? He had signed. So he said, okay, I'll teach you a lesson. He printed these t-shirts. That's his face on that t-shirt. It says, IndusInd Bank cheated me, it can cheat you as well. And he used to go to the branch every day wearing that t-shirt and he used to sing and he used to dance. Okay, I think on the third or fourth day that he did it, somebody wrote to us and told us about it. And then we took up this case and we wrote about it and we wrote to the PR agency, we wrote to the bank, we wrote to the RBI. Then we put it all over social media. The next evening after we wrote it, they actually went to his house and returned his check of 7 lakhs because they didn't want the reputational damage. So sometimes bit of Gandhigiri, bit of unusual things work. So think out of the box and you can get justice. I come to the next thing, which is banks and fixed deposits. Lots of people think these are interchangeable, okay? They say bank deposit safe hai? Yes, safe hai. Fixed deposits in companies are not equal to bank deposits, okay? You have to look at each company separately. Don't even go by brand names. There are even some Tata companies that have not paid. You have a Tata Finance that at one time collapsed. There's been Kirloskar companies that failed. The latest is, of course, Yash Birla, who has money in Swiss banks but won't pay back people over here. So don't go by big brand names. Each company, you have to look at the finances, look at the credit rating. Remember, credit ratings change, so you have to track it, not only look at it at the time that you're investing. And if they offer you 3% or higher than a bank FD, or they offer you a 3% or higher plus a gift, you need to worry. That's not a sign of safe money. That is a clear sign that you need to worry that something is dramatically wrong, because no businessman is going to pay you even 0.25% more than he has to. They're not running a charity. So they are going to borrow money at the lowest possible rate. If they can't borrow from the market, they can't do equity, they can't do anything else, then they do fixed deposits. And when they do fixed deposits, if they're giving you more, it means that they can't borrow for less. Right? So don't be happy that he company mala jasta dete. I've heard this so many times, but I get 1% more and I'm retired. That 1% makes a difference to me. No, you have to protect your capital first. That is more important post-retirement.
It is also applicable for bonds and debentures.
Bonds and debentures are not unsecured. This is unsecured, which means that if something goes wrong, you're the last in the queue to get the money back. All the secured creditors get their money first. And usually there's nothing left by then. So the next one, I'm coming to insurance. And I must say, insurance is a vast subject. We've written 30 cover stories. This month, we're going to have 2 seminars on insurance separately. So this is just a few highlights of what you need to worry about. I'm not going to get into details. But it is the opposite, literally, of the buyer beware syndrome. The insurance company takes you on utmost good faith, which means that when you fill the form, they may or may not ask you for a medical. They assume that you're going to fill it correctly and honestly. If you have hypertension, you're going to talk about it. If you have diabetes, you're going to say it. You're going to put your age correctly so that you get the right amount. They are not worried about anything when you fill the form. So please do not believe anybody who says, "Haan rehne do, wo nahi dekhega." Instead of, you know, 63, you put 65, you're born 2 years later, "Main hoon na, I will look at it." No, it doesn't work. Because they are going to collect premium from you when you fill the form. They have nothing to worry about. They start looking at the form with a big, thick magnifying glass the day you make a claim. Okay? Every single thing that can be wrong and can be reason to deny your claim, they're going to use it at that time. Which means when you are in serious trouble, you are ill, you've gone through a hospitalization or about to go through it, you have met with an accident and you need the money, that is the time they will focus on what may be wrong in your form. Okay? And nobody can help at that time. You make a wrong decision, it's a wrong decision. We have had, again, too many cases where people say, "Agent was someone I knew very well." He said, don't worry, koi dekhega nahi. Mil gaya na aapko policy. Mil gaya policy is no big deal, you are paying. Right? Mil gaya claim is what you have to worry about. So insurance is very different from your regular investment. You have to think about it. Do you need insurance? 100% you need insurance most of the time, because it is for unforeseen contingencies. After a certain age, maybe you need to think about it, because medical insurance costs are becoming very, very high. And, you know, celebrity endorsements is something that I've talked about here. People tell you to buy. You can't buy the policy, buy it in the name of your child. Please don't do it, because it's the wrong policy. Child plans have given very, very low returns, and if you can give higher returns to your children by putting your money elsewhere.
I have a question here, can I?
Sure.
See, in the old days that we are talking about, why invest in insurance policies? I feel the insurance save for 5 lakhs. Ultimately, there is some...
Create your own medical fund. I have it over there.
Yeah? Is you buy some mutual fund which can be encashed in 3 or 4
Correct.
Days. And on that you earn maybe less, maybe 2%, 3%, 4%, whatever. But when you need it, you can encash it. You get it in 4 days.
Things, so
correct to think like
yeah, because after the age of 60, when medical insurance becomes really expensive, there are lots of people who have been saying that if you're going to pay 50,000 to 60,000 rupees as premium,
it
makes sense. It may not even be a mutual fund, maybe a fixed deposit. In fact, there's a think tank called Stratford which has sent a report saying you must allow us to have one fixed deposit, which, you know, and give tax exemptions on it, which is meant only for medical emergencies, because it may make sense to have that kind of fixed deposit. As long as you don't break it without backing it up with medical certificates, then, in fact, they're demanding that it should be tax-free. And we also feel that, you know, increasingly with medical insurance costs being so high, it is a better way. In fact, even for some younger people, I know someone who was asking me last week that his daughter had cancer. Okay, she's fully recovered, but her insurance costs are so high now, and she doesn't even get insurance for everything. So they keep saying, keep aside cancer, for the rest of it, why won't you give? She's not getting insurance at any reasonable rate. So I think we need to, when I say we, advocacy is needed for senior citizens and all of us should lobby, we need to make our voice heard on this, because we are paying huge amounts. And I think this kind of fixed deposit is something that we need to lobby very hard for, and the government must allow it. whether the government allows it or not, mutual funds, you don't pay tax. So ideally, it will be mutual funds. But, you know, not everybody is smart enough to invest in mutual funds, SIPs, liquid funds. So even a FD is worth it.
Yeah, but FD generally, you know, some banks now, they don't charge any penalty if you break.
Yeah, but some do.
Yeah, some do. So better would be the mutual fund.
Correct. So either
that
if...
my thing, yeah, I want to ask... whether it is correct.
No, it is sound. So it's, you know, whatever, whether it's FDs or mutual funds is always a much better investment for those who know it. Lots of people will say we don't understand funds. For them, at least an FD. But I think if we can over time get the government also to recognize that this pool should be allowed, then that would be much better for all of us.
Thank you. I'm
now going to go through a series of little things which are more like tips rather than anything else. Okay, so avoid emotional traps. We, again, lots of things that I say at these seminar are examples, live examples that have come here. So we had one case where the son persuades the father that, you know, our house is small, let's combine the two and buy a bigger flat. Most people say yes. The EMI was going to be on the son's name, so the father's name was not in it. And the family broke up. The parents were ended up in an old people's home, even though they had the house. Okay, and these are stories that happen in India. They're not a surprise. So if you are ever going to pool it, even if it is your child, at least demand joint ownership so you maintain your rights and don't fall for an emotional trap. Don't take credit cards in the name of children, for God's sake. I mean, wife, yes, but if it's a really young child, it's one thing. But otherwise, credit cards are the big way in which you can land into all kinds of problems, especially when you want to go abroad and you need a credit card. As it is, things get more and more difficult when you're going abroad. You don't get medical insurance, traveling becomes a problem, it's not easy. If you don't even have a credit card because, you know, someone has defaulted and you very generously took a second card and a third card in various names, this is what I call emotional trap. There have been some dangerous cases. Today, luckily, no bank asks anyone to introduce people. But if you are asked to be an introducer or guarantor, please look at it very, very carefully. I'm not saying don't do it at all. There may be some unusual circumstances in which you feel confident enough to do it, but don't do it for anyone at all, because they say this one case where a man introduced someone who turned out to get into trouble as a Kashmiri militant. And for 35 years, this man has fought a case where he was finally relieved through the Supreme Court, all because he introduced him to a bank. Okay, so if it's not necessary, don't do it. It's never worth it. And when I say about children, do you know that Suresh Prabhu was declared a defaulter? He had a phone which he bought in his son's name. Okay, son went abroad. The phone was lying around somewhere. They forgot about the bills. So when he went to renew his credit card, they said, sorry, you're a defaulter. So he said, what on earth? The minister, he got it done. They paid. You have to pay the back bills, okay? There's no question. And those bills compound. So they could get it eliminated. But when I say you're buying anything for someone else, you are not in charge. You don't know what it is. Think twice, because I'm not talking about you and me. It happened to him also. Right?
Suppose the signature of the guarantor is forged.
Then you can prove it. Then you'll have to prove it.
But yeah? It take a long process.
See, those are way off things. These are things that you will face. Something happens, some murder happens, you know.
Does a bank take a verification?
You'll have to fight it out. You'll have to get some proof. You'll have to ask the bank. When you guarantee, there is no verification. But if you are in a situation like that, you'll have to fight it out. You're talking about forgery, right? Yeah. So, make a list of your financial commitments, ensure that nominations, I'm going to come to nominations a little later, this is the last segment that I'm handling. Then a will, we'll talk about that also. Guarantors, I've already told you. What happened to Suresh Prabhu is a part of understanding credit scores, which is that if you default on payments, every payment where you are, whether it's your phone bills, which are now part of the credit history, they want electricity bills as well, your credit cards, any borrowing that you have. The minute you borrow any kind of loan, that data goes to these four companies, CIBIL, Experian, Equifax, and Chris Highmark. And it remains in their books. So you're a defaulter, you don't get another loan. In the US, you get it at a much higher interest rate. In India, we have not done anything. So we started these credit bureaus about 10-15 years ago, then we allowed three more to come, and now if you're a defaulter, you're a defaulter. It becomes very, very difficult to rebuild your credit unless someone gives you. In fact, we run a credit helpline especially to try and help people, and believe me, 6 months after we have started it, we are still talking to the RBI to say people who did not even know the concept of credit histories have been marked defaulter. You have to find a way to give them small new loans so that they rebuild their credit. It's a slow process. We are fighting for it still. So stuff like paying someone else's bills, it's all part of the emotional traps I talk about. Be really careful. Protect yourself. Now this is something again a lot of seniors have to be aware of. I hope nobody in this room needs it, but today there is a law which talks about maintenance and welfare of parents and senior citizens. Now there is a lot of advocacy required over here also. Law has been passed. Not many states have implemented it properly. Maharashtra, there is a case going on because they haven't set up all the things that are required under this act, but at least there's an act. You can file a case and you can demand and get up to 10,000 rupees as maintenance. And this act, according to me, is really important, even to middle class people, because I've told you, we did a survey, we were shocked at people saying that anything for my child. So doesn't matter if I won't have a penny in my old age, my children will look after me. This is our traditional way of thinking, and children don't always look after parents, and parents are left destitute after having done. It's not about watching a movie Bagban, it's real life. So you have to be careful, and I'm glad that this act is there, but all of us need to get together to ensure that act has more teeth. Then there is the reverse mortgage product that I talked about. So if you have a house, you can, it's the exact opposite of taking a loan. So when you take a loan, you get to live in your house and you're paying for it over 20 years. Now reverse mortgage is you have the house, it's fully paid for, you're living in it. You can take out bits of that value of the loan until your death. So now there are two kinds of schemes. Again, this requires lots of advocacy because neither of the schemes, you know, give the kind of returns that they ought to give. In the US, this is considered part of the social security system that the government runs. Okay, so the insurance risk on this is borne by the government, which is why they can offer much higher returns when you take it. Here, every product requires a bank to take the banking risk and an insurance company to come there for the insurance risk. And so the returns that they're giving you are lower, but doesn't matter. You know, there are two kinds of reverse mortgage. One is where you want it to go after you to your child. So suppose your house is worth 5 crores. You have lived till say the age of 100. You have drawn down 3 crores of that value. There's still 2 crores of value left in the house. So you can ensure that it goes to your children or your heirs. So they have the choice of paying back the 3 crores and getting the house, or selling the house and getting the remaining 2 crores. It doesn't remain with the insurance company. The second option is where you have nobody to leave it to. And so you say, I don't care, I want a higher return when I'm alive. And it, this is not just you, you and your wife get to stay in it until the end of your life. Okay, so you don't need to leave. But you say, I don't necessarily want the house back and I don't want to leave it to anybody. You get a higher return in that case. Okay, the returns ought to be better. These are not great products, but it's a beginning. And believe me, it's a wonderful beginning, because 5 years or 7 years ago, you didn't even have these. Both these things have just started. When we started Moneylife Foundation, so around 2010, these products were introduced. And when I keep saying, I wish we senior citizens organizations to get together to lobby for these things, you know, this doesn't even come up in every single budget. We had one chairman of NHB who was very interested in 2010-11, so you had products. If the chairman is not interested, it doesn't matter. He also told us lots of times the children actively dissuade parents from going for reverse mortgage. And they are cruel enough to say things like, at your age, why do you want the money? You know, why can't you live within the means that you have? So I keep saying, be financially independent. Today, you can really live life even at the age of 80. Please think of yourself first and draw down value if you need it. The third thing is get connected. Okay, shocking statistics according to me is that only 6% of people above 50 use mobiles. Is it surprising? Above 50, huh? I'm not even talking about 60. And I hear too many people saying, I reluctant to get a mobile. And then when things like depression and other things happen, you get more and more lonely and cut out. My mother is 83. She's on Facebook. She has a WhatsApp group. I would strongly urge, and if you want, we would also, in fact, one of the things we plan to do this year is try and do seminars to create this basic digital literacy for safely being on these products, because this connects you to your relatives, connects you to your friends group. So if you want to go and listen to a pravachan, or you want to listen to music, or just go to a movie, it is so easy to send one WhatsApp message and find company. Loneliness is something which is everybody needs to deal with. The second part, which is more important, is the e-commerce stuff. Okay, you know how tough it is, even to have, you're well off, even to have a driver, because you're not going to go out of the house, you know, 10 times a day. You're not going out for an 8-hour work shift. You need a driver for maybe 3 times a week when you want to go out. It's not possible. So you want to get cabs that will come to your house when you just press a button on an app, know that it's available, know that there's a reasonable amount of safety. You want groceries delivered to your door. All this is possible online today. So I feel making a serious effort to understand basic of, you know, being online transactions, mobile transactions, I think it's a necessity, and we would be happy to help. So you have your feedback forms. If you think any of this is important, please write, because we structure our seminars based on the feedback that we have. So we have enough of people saying they want it, then only we would do it. Otherwise, of course, there are lots of senior citizen organizations. Maybe others do it, I don't know, but it's an important thing. If you want to know what benefits are available to you as a senior citizen, then this is a portal that you can look at. Luckily, under Narendra Modi, one of the things that he has focused on is all the websites, right? So I looked at this portal recently, and every single kind of benefit that is available to senior citizens is listed here, including the ability to file complaints. So strongly urge that you'll take it down. If you'll want this and you haven't written it down now, just ask us, we will send it to you. Going through a quick little segment on retirement communities. This is an interesting new thing, because it's very different from old people's homes. Every time we tell people about retirement communities, they say, no, I get along fine with my family. Why will I go to an old age home? It is not about whether you get along with your family or not. In fact, if you get along with your family, all the more you want to live with people who are like you. You may not want to be hassled with, you know, depending on where you stay, too many young people, too many children. There are all kinds of things that we want to tolerate or not tolerate. There are lovely communities that are coming up. One problem with it, I must mention upfront, is that they are not regulated as yet. So this is another area where a lot of advocacy is required, because the government must put these under some regulator. And I'll tell you why. Because it's a beautiful option for people, but you need to be careful how you choose it. Don't go in for a purchase option, because you are locking up all your funds. So everything looks five star when you look at a retirement community. They look beautiful, okay? But remember that you are going to have to stay there for the rest of your life. And if you put in your savings over there, what when the laundry work? There's somebody I know who is going to come and attend this seminar. He worked with, he's an IIM Ahmedabad CEO of a Gulf Oil subsidiary. He went to Coimbatore, looked beautiful. He went with 3 people from his family, all senior citizens, and they're spending all their time fighting the management, because the cook runs away. So there's a common kitchen or the laundry, but there are lots that work well, including some in Pune, which people swear by, and they say they love to stay there. So some few key factors that you need to look at. One is, when you are looking at a post-retirement community, don't say that I want to live in Goa or I want to live in Darjeeling, because those are wonderful places for a 6-day holiday. For the rest of your life, you want people like you around you, your culture, your language, you begin to miss it. A Pune couple went to Darjeeling, sold it and at a loss, and came back to Pune in 6 months' time, because they found they're missing everybody. It's beautiful to stay in a seaside resort or go all the way to Ooty or Coimbatore. But if your family is in Maharashtra, there's not even flight connections. It means that you are cutting yourself off. So a retirement community is not what you go to escape your family. You want to come back for weddings, for family occasions. You want to be there occasionally and you want to enjoy it. So don't go too far away. Don't go to places where you can't reach a hospital or a city with good medical facilities. Remember, you're doing it in your retirement time. So you have to be aware that anything can happen. You need medical facilities. That is important. So while you go, don't choose any place that doesn't have a guest house which will allow you to stay for 5 days to check it out. Because it's not about taking a tour. Okay? You take a tour, it looks good. When you stay for 5 days, you will know even what kind of food is being served for 5 days and whether they have an effective laundry that works all the time or it's an occasional thing where they just show you a good room and say, we have a laundry and this is our dispensary and that is the ambulance, but the ambulance doesn't work or there's no driver or there's no hospital connecting. So go and stay there. Look for rental places rather than, you know, I think Dignity Lifestyles has something where you pay a deposit. Even if you pay a small rent, it's worth it. But when you do a purchase option, it immediately means that you have to sell only to a senior citizen, which means that you are reducing your universe of possible buyers down to less than 20%. You can never get the price. So if you find you made a mistake, you have no exit route. So you have to remember that it may be a beautiful experience. It may be something that you say, okay, 2 years I enjoyed it, but now I want to come back to my family. Keep that option open all the time. Don't sell everything and go away. And don't do it in a fit of anger because you're fed up of your daughter-in-law or your son is fighting with you. Do it as a lifestyle change after a lot of thought. So I listed several key factors. It's not a short holiday. Don't tie up your money. I think we've talked about all of this. So I now go to my last section, which is estate planning and wills. Okay, so these are the various ways in which you can decide all the effort that you made all your life to earn. You have to finally decide what to do with it, right? So will is, of course, the best way in which you can pass on what you have. Gift is, the will is something that you, that happens after you. So you decide what you're going to do with assets that you have, which are self-earned. That's important to remember. Gift is something which is like a deed of settlement. You give it during your lifetime to whoever you want to give. A trust is something that you create usually when people are worried about young children, children with special needs. Sometimes people even do trusts when they have animals. You know, they have 8 cats, 4 dogs. They don't know who's going to look after them. They create a trust. Trusts are very expensive in India and we don't have too many answers. Like the good working trusts cost a lot of money to create as well as to maintain, because somebody has to execute what you want and that part is expensive. Nominations, I'm going to talk about. It's very important and comes even before you do any wills. Power of attorney, you all know what it is. You give someone the right to use it. Insurance is also part of estate planning, because when you insure yourself, you ensure that your family is taken care of. So that is definitely a part of retirement. The next is, of course, the Hindu undivided family, which has its own set of rules. In this short presentation, I'm not going to get into it. But let me talk about wills. Wills can be made only for self-owned property. You have to earn it, inherited property. You cannot make a will. All succession is governed by different succession acts, which depends on your community. The Indian Succession Act applies to most Sikhs, Jains, Hindus. There are 2 succession acts. The Christians also come under the Indian Succession Act. Muslims have their own. And there also there's a difference. The Sunnis and the Shias have slight differences in the Succession Act. One key difference is that the Muslim Succession Act decides in what proportion money can be distributed. And I think the wife gets only 1/6. And they can make an oral will. So other than people who are in the middle of a battle, on a ship, or the Muslim Succession Act, all wills have to be in writing. It can be your own writing. It need not have witnesses. So if it is entirely written by you on a plain piece of paper, it's called a holographic will, which is also allowed. But otherwise, you need 2 witnesses who sign in front of each other. They don't need to read the will, but they have to initial it and they have to do it in front of each other. And it has no registration requirement, no stamp duty. You can change your will every single day. Okay? The last will count. And So it is called the last will and testament, because you can write a will every day. Even if you have forgotten to tear it off, it doesn't matter. As long as every time you write a will, you put a fresh date. And you have a first line saying that this will be my will in revocation of anything else that I have written in the past. So usually there are fights when different people come up with different wills. You know, this happens to very rich people. They've died and there are five people coming with five different wills. It's allowed. Okay. So it'll go through a process where there will be a judicial process to decide which one is correct. But you can write it, you can tear it up. If you don't want to write a new will, you've forgotten something, you got something else, you bought something, you don't need to rewrite your will again. You can just write a codicil which adds it. So you got a new property and you don't want to change the will. You've written everything, you want it to go in the same way. So then you will just have a codicil which says, okay, now I've acquired this asset, which means that this bank account I had left money, that is reduced, and this property will go to so and so. So you can just change it with a little codicil. You need to have an executor, name an executor for your will. And when you do that, be very careful that it is someone who's willing to do the job, because it's a tough job. Sometimes you have to go to court and you have to, you know, it has to follow a process, especially if there's a dispute. There is no dispute, it is usually fast. So if your children know, they all agree with what you've said, then there is really no problem as long as there is a will written. But even before that, one way that you, I think we've run through all the basic facts, can be revoked. There's a residual clause, there's a codicil. Yeah, identify yourself. This is really important, because while you may write a fully holographic handwritten will, if you don't say who you are, so you say you are Ramamurthy Subramanyam, there may be N number of them around the country. So you say, I am so and so, living at so and so place, age so and so, this is my date of birth, so that it's very clear. Do the same thing with your children, so that you say, I have three children, my eldest son's name is so and so, his age is so and so, so that there is no doubt about the identity of who you are leaving anything to. Second, if you're leaving something, it's an easier thing to do. So you say, you know, I have three flats, one will go to X, one will go to Y, one will go to Z. Now if you've decided that you're going to disinherit one, or you're going to give the bigger flat to X and a really tiny one to Y, and you have in your mind, you know why you're doing it, because Y is earning 10 times the money as X, so you feel that your son X, who's got a job, who's doing more of social work, and he hasn't hankered after money, you want to leave him the bigger house. And Y, who's earning, you know, a crore of rupees in a hedge fund, you don't think he needs the money, you're leaving something small for him, maybe a bank deposit. Explain all that in the will, okay? So that there's no fight after you, and it's very clear why you're doing this, that you're mentally sound. Now, this is another condition, that only people of sound mind can write a will, and it is challenged usually on the basis that whether you're sound mind or not. And that's why when people get witnesses, now anybody can be a witness, but people recommend that if you can get a doctor and maybe a CA or a lawyer, then two things are taken care of. A, the doctor knows that you're of sound mind, and the lawyer or the CA will be able to say, yes, these assets belong to you. So you're not leaving the Taj Mahal or the Qutub Minar to anybody. You can't do it. If you write it in the will also, it's of no use. So you have to be careful about that. And I keep saying, please do not say, too many people here say, can I write a will where my wife gets to enjoy my property when she's alive and then it goes to my son? And I usually say, leave it to the wife. She's given birth to the kids. She's anyway going to leave it to them. She's not going to give it to somebody else. So don't leave your wife, please, to the mercy of others. And when I say others, I mean children as well. Many, many women, you know the average statistics, women survive their husbands by an average of 6 years, the global number. Okay? So please think about what is going to happen. Lots of women land up in old people's homes when their husbands are no longer there, because they're suddenly seen as having no rights. So please take care of her first. And if you don't, you know, this is how when I talked about Succession Act, there are clear ways in which your property is divided. So you say, I didn't write a will, what happens? If you didn't write a will, then the Succession Act spells out different layers of who comes first, who comes. So if you have the first line relatives, which could be son, daughter, widow, mother, you know, children of someone who's son or daughter, So it goes in this order. Now, if these are not there, it will go to the second rung of more distant relatives, and it's clearly specified, and your inheritance is decided like that. So if having worked for something very hard, if you have strong thoughts on who should get it, some people say, "Are mere baad, who do I care? What do I care for?" It's a lovely attitude, but if you care, then make sure you write a will, right? Now, importance of nominations. Now, lots of people don't want to write wills, but nomination is something that you have to do on a continuous basis all your life, because nomination in a lot of software, like you talked about that software where direct debits are a problem, they don't get updated. So if you have FDs, the easiest and first way to ensure that money goes to the people you intend to is nominations. We had someone in this room who came and said, my father decided to, you know, nominate his friends and business partners in his FDs. I mean, I don't know what is more foolish than that, because those people wouldn't give the money to the family after he died. Okay. So he had come to attend the seminar to say, what should I do? And honestly, other than a long legal battle, there's nothing you can do. So, and this people do with women, okay? So lots of men say, my wife doesn't know. The managing director of a German firm tells me my wife doesn't know how to handle a bank account. Then teach her, okay? But don't leave some neighbor as a nominee because the wife doesn't know to go to the bank. So be very careful with nominations. It has serious consequences. This is a story that appeared in the Bangalore Mirror, where 1.4 crore is what the guy had in a savings account, okay? He was married, he got divorced. His wife remarried. Within 6 months of the divorce, he died. Okay? He has lots of money. And the wife was still a nominee. This is sloppy divorce procedure, because a lawyer should have checked that all his assets, the nomination was removed. You know, which woman is going to let go of 1.44 crore because she's got married again? So she fought. And the poor mother, I think, had to wait some 7 years to fight a legal battle. And without too much of precedence, the court finally, I think more on humanitarian grounds, said, I'm giving this money to the mother. Because there was a proper divorce settlement, the woman is married. This money was definitely not meant to go to her. And he gave it to the mother. But, you know, simple nomination, being up to date on it, could have made all the difference. And this is not the only one. These are two, both are real stories, okay, and have been narrated here. The first, this happens to everybody. They start working, open a bank account. The nominee is usually the mother, not the father. Father is a bread earner, so people like to put the mother or sister or some brother as a nominee. So the guy died at the age of 45. Everything was linked to one nominee, which was his brother. Had fought with the brother 10 years before he died. And what happens? Now, you can fight a legal battle. The wife and the children have to get the money. But it's a legal battle which is expensive. If his nomination was correct and up to date, it wouldn't have gone to them. This was, the first was a Citibank case. And Citibank's representative was here, and she said, you know, we felt sorry for the woman. We knew that she ought to get it. Legally, there's nothing we could do. All we did is found ways to delay allowing him access to the money so that she could go and file a caveat in court that he shouldn't spend it. Because the minute it's cash and banks, you can just spend it. And you can say, nahi hai paisa, keep fighting. Okay? Anything that goes to court in India is 10-year battle. So be careful with that. The second, again, true story, the guy dies at the age of 30, has a wife and two kids. Elder sister is the nominee. He hasn't changed it. So please go home, do that checklist and look at it. Women need to be more careful. You make sure that your husbands have the nomination up to date and see whose name is over there. Lots of people India did not need us to register marriages. It's become a mandatory requirement. So a lot of senior citizens do not have a registration. It is not legally required. But if you have a registration certificate and you can register it at any time, it has up-to-date information, including about your children. It becomes the best way to smoothen succession, even for getting family pensions or pension claims where you're working. So if you don't have this, please get it. We have Mr. Shanbagh, who helps us with our credit line. In fact, he's written an article on this, and he evangelizes this. So anyone needs help, write to us, and Mr. Shanbagh would be very happy to help people on this. Finally, Married Women's Property Act. This is for people who are in business, and if they want to ensure that they have an insurance policy which will go only to the woman, their wife and the children, then any insurance policy you can say that I want it opened under the Married Women's Property Act. There is one catch here, that having opened that policy, you can't change the nominees. It will go to them. You will have to keep paying the premium. But no creditors or anybody, if there's a bankruptcy or something else, nobody else can touch the money. It goes only to the beneficiary. And it's a good policy to have. It's especially useful for people who are in high-risk businesses. I'm just going to finish it and ask the questions. Huh? So I know you had a question. So I'm coming to the last section, which is the living will and what we call Ichha Maran. Okay? This has been much under discussion at the moment, especially after the Aruna Shanbhag case. And lots of people ask, what should we do? Now, it is not legal in India. After the Aruna Shanbhag case, when somebody else talked about euthanasia, the Supreme Court has spelled out detailed guidelines about what can be done, but it's still not legal. Having said that, there are two organizations which are fighting very hard to say why shouldn't we have it. There are dangers here as well, which is that, you know, it can be used to bump off people sometimes. So you have to be careful about having a living will because people can misuse it. And it essentially allows you to die with dignity and to say that if I'm at some time in my life on tubes and ventilator, should I keep the machine on or should it be shut off? So a lot of people say we like to write it because people around us shouldn't have to worry about are they doing the right thing or the wrong thing. Would, you know, my parent want to continue living in this condition or should I pull the plug? So that's a decision you make easier for people and for your, I mean, I don't even know whether you do anything for yourself or not. I'm sure all of you have done a lot of thinking after reading the Aruna Shanbhag case. I did, and I don't even know what she knew or she didn't. You, on one hand, you had the nurses in the hospital who said that she was alive, she was sensitive, she expressed her anger, you have no right to kill her, and I agree with that. On the other hand, was that a life? I don't know. But the point is, she was in no position to tell. And many of us have to prepare for the fact that we will be in that position sometime. So even when it is not legal, if you write it down somewhere, it is something that people pay attention to when you are in that situation. And like I said, there are people fighting for it. So there's a Dr. B.N. Kulabawala who has prepared a draft will, and he says it has adequate safeguards. And there is a bunch of people who are fighting very hard to push it through, you know, to have this legalized. Dr. Suren Delia is another one. And I mean, I can understand doctors doing this because they really see tragic cases all the time. And the Supreme Court has gone halfway, but as you know, in the Aruna Shanbhag case, they said, no, you can't do euthanasia, and maybe quite correctly. But there are many countries where this is legal. So thank you, and we will now take questions. I know that you had questions. Yeah.
My name is Patil Gaikwad. Why not to give will copy to the beneficiary itself? Because you have to speak to anybody, you know, so you explain to them correctly that, you know, this is to you, this is to you.
No, it's a simple thing, but let me tell you again, our learnings, okay, from what we do over here. I know somebody who was extremely well off and had three children, and he thought he was doing the very smart thing of doing a will. He called all three children and said, I'm leaving this to you. This is what each one of you get. And he says, my whole family life has been destroyed. All the children were dissatisfied with it. They kept fighting. They're fighting with him. Nobody is happy. So I don't know. I think it all depends on person to person. You may have children who will say, humko kuch nahi chahiye. And then it's a wonderful thing. He did that. My point is that because he did it and he told them, it didn't work. They started fighting with each other rather than saying thank you.
This should be taken as a different case actually, but you know, if you explain to them properly.
No, sir, it human mind and human greed is something that none of us can talk. There are people, I mean, you've seen the famous cases, right? You saw the Amarchand Mangaldas case. Do they have less? Aren't they fighting? You look at the Birla case, okay? 3,000, I mean they have thousands of crores. So Priyambada Birla died and left the money to her accountant, so what, you know?
But they might not explain to them properly.
There is never an explanation. You saw the, for 3,000, anyway, I don't want to get into this because there is no answer. It, human nature is something that none of us have answers to, but I know that in 3,000 crore case also, when each one had more than 3,000 crore, which they would not have spent in 10 generations, they fought tooth and nail all the way to the Supreme Court. So there is no easy answer. I think you will know your family the best. So what may work perfectly for your family, this may be the most wonderful solution for you, may not be the solution for her. So I think we should leave it to our own judgment.
And the second thing is, what happens to the property which is not earned actually? It is inherited.
It goes by the Succession Act. What you have inherited will be decided only by the succession. No, you can't will it. No, you can't put it in the will. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, is the understanding correct that in spite of nomination being made, the will take precedence?
Absolutely.
Nomination?
Yeah.
Number two, in case the will is not done, but the nomination is there, will the Succession Act take precedence?
Yeah, so it's a good question. So see, suppose your nominee is your neighbor, okay? Should not happen, but the nominee is the neighbor. And you have children who ought to inherit under the Succession Act. Then your children will go for probate and will demand that the nominee gives the money to the children, and they have to give it. So the nominee is not the owner, the nominee holds it in trust. But if that nominee is not correctly chosen, in India, it means a long legal battle for the children to go and fight. And then if it is cash and it's a bank account, the person can say, first, I've spent the money. Okay?
Probate is expensive. Who will pay for that?
Probate is expensive, tiring, delays, and that's where the executor comes in. Because if your executor is not someone you've chosen correctly, most of the time he says, mujhe kyun magazmari karna hai? So a lot of times you have to ensure that someone who's going to get a lot of your assets is the executor, because then he has an interest in ensuring, even if it means settling. Okay? So sometimes somebody may crib, the executor is going to get, he's getting a large chunk of your property. He may say, chalo, I will give you 2 lakhs to compensate. You've got less, but let's not fight. Let's end it. So choose your executor very, very carefully. Yes, sir.
See, if you are unsound mind, who will decide that? Because in the case of Balasaheb Thackeray, his other son has
correct
got to the court, correct, and still it is not yet decided.
The court will decide. When it's challenged and it goes for the probate, then the court decides.
Can be anybody.
How can a rented asset be represented in the will for passing on to the...
It depends on whether it is this pagdi system, which is now fairly legal, then those rent receipts have to be transferred and it can be mentioned. So you should mention it in the will and you should mention the circumstances of the property.
If only one child is there, then where is the need of
it? No, there's no need at all. No need at all. And in fact, then all this probate and other things also don't happen. Doesn't matter.
Unless you want to give a gift to somebody.
Ha, if you want to give it away, then in your lifetime also you can give the gift.
The spouse will be there, the child's mother.
She's not talking about that situation, I think. Isn't it?
I didn't hear.
She said the spouse may be there. So if there is a husband and a wife and a child, then you have to think about the spouse.
Those are correct.
I'm going to stop now. We can take it one to one because otherwise you're not going to have time for tea. Yeah? So let's break for tea and thank you so much.